The Fooge is in the house for this extreme retro review for ECW, August 20th, 1996. For the illustrious, sought-after, highly elusive, coveted edition of the Tape Traders Show, the time was 54 minutes and 27 seconds for extreme retro review number 214. I would ask my partner in crime his thoughts and views, as well as the time from the WWE Network. But even though he got the notification of the itinerary of what was on deck for this show, he was unable to watch this show, failing the 252 Legion of Street Smarks. So with it being August 20th, 1996, this is the go-home show for Natural Born Killers. My partner in crime would always say that ECW would have a long-running trope of having terrible go-home shows. But since he never watched a show, he can't honestly make that decision. But I will tell you of a longer trope in extreme retro review lore. The trope of my partner in crime always missing one show per year. Because he's missed a show in 1993, a show in 1994, a show in 1995. And let's run that shit back one more time.
Oh, shit.
1996. Doofus Hollywood is in the building from Earth 73. Yeti Gein.
Hi, guys. The 252. I do want to apologize for failing you, because as the paragon of professionalism, I hold myself to the highest standard, because when I come to this microphone, I want you to be able to trust and believe what I'm saying. So I do apologize for letting y'all down. Fooge, I apologize for misreading or not reading your text, however it went down, because clearly it's right there. But guess what? I am still the best there is at what I do. I am the great one for a reason. I am the longest reigning 177th and Harvard champion in history. 7-year reign on that ass. Fuck with me, you know what I'm saying? So I'm still going to be able to contribute to what is probably a terrible go-home show for the next super show, or whatever they call they shit.
So we start with a cold open of the finish of the four-way dance at the Doctor Is In, recounted by us, Extreme Retro Review number 211.
I saw that, and you're welcome.
And then it fades to a shot of New Jack. Now, over the course of this series, we've done our evolution of a franchise, the hardcore monologues, soliloquy of a crippler, evolution of a putz, and now, narrated by New Jack, I present to you Tales from the Hood. He says, this all started when he got a call that his nephew is gone. He said, what you mean gone? The hood took him under. Gang violence and a stray bullet took him out while he was sleeping. The EMTs and the police came through, but they ain't do shit. All the money he done made in wrestling ain't been enough. So they had to win the tag team titles to get more money to move his family out of the projects. And they gonna move out the projects by any means necessary. It then goes into a splice of the gangster shit, you know, path towards the tag team titles, and it's spliced in with the video of Natural Born Killers by Dr. Dre and Ice Cube. And it culminates with them winning the tag team titles. It fades back to New Jack, and he's resuming his tale. He said Mustafa told him he ain't never seen New Jack act like that in the ring. New Jack then told Mustafa that for 3 weeks, his mama cried because they couldn't get his nephew a tombstone for his grave. So they had to win them titles. He had to get the money for the tombstone.
That was sound like it was a deep promo there by New Jack. So a nice way to build sympathy from the audience and shit, and motivations to their character and shit. Sound like that was some thought out. Or if it was real, it was smart of New Jack to, you know what I'm saying, use that for the fucking wrestling and shit, you know what I'm saying? So it sounds like it was pretty good.
I felt that shit. One of the takeaways of ECW as a whole was, you know, that New Jack was one of the better talkers of the promotion. He said some shit early in 1996, and here we go with this Tales from the Hood shit. I'm seeing the death. I'm seeing, you know, he's connecting with the audience. He connected with me, so I understand why the people pop for him.
That's good shit.
We got Joey at the Nest hyping the Natural Born Killers match between the Gangsters and the Eliminators for the tag team straps on the 24th. He also hypes tonight's show, and on the 23rd of August, where they will honor Pitbull number one, Gary Wolf.
His last name is Wolf? They should have been the Werewolves. Oh, man, they missed the boat. I mean, no disrespect to Gary, a.k.a. Pitbull number one. At his little retirement party, he needs to do the right thing and give the Pitbull number one name to Pitbull number two, and let this nigga be the Pitbull like he was and shit, you know what I'm saying? And do the right thing, because it's not right for Pitbull number two to be Pitbull number two and he the nigga being put over and shit and wrestling Shane Douglas and shit.
We have an ECW spot for the Dr. Azen recounted by us, Extreme Retro Review number 211.
You're welcome.
We have a Catalog Shield, a House of Hardcore Shield, and a Club ECW re-up for you super nerds. Moving on. We have a promo featuring the franchise Shane Douglas and Francine via fan cam.
Oh, shit.
Franchise expresses vehemently that he will not be at the retirement ceremony on the 23rd of August honoring Pitbull number one. Him and Francine have to fuck. He buries Pitbull number one for being a cripple. Francine then comes in and makes a joke. Shout out to the zero subscribers of Street Smart Video. She says, "Hey Gary, what's this? It's Pitbull number one driving a car."
That's fucked up.
I love Francine.
Cold-blooded.
Franchise then dares the ECW fans of Reading to show up and earn the wrath of the franchise.
Who wants to earn somebody's wrath, though?
We have a t-shirt spot for the Brian Pillman censored t-shirt. Brad. Moving on. We have an ECW spot for Hardcore Heaven 1996. Recounted by us, Extreme Retro Review number 203.
You're welcome. You're welcome.
Back with Joey at the Nest. He's got the solemn voice, and he's talking about Shane Douglas and Francine and the Pitbull's entire saga. They do a quick montage, and it goes to the replay of Pitbull number one's farewell and the great call by Joey Styles, where he says, "Tonight, in this ring, Shane Douglas will face off against Pitbull number two." I just love that fucking call. I just love it. It's just like, you are so not, it's like, when you get wrestling and other motherfuckers get what you get, it's that great fucking feeling. You know what I'm saying? No homo. But it's like, you are so far off base with this Pitbull shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, you just don't see it. You know what I mean? And I'm just waiting for the moment to come for you to just, like, oh, I get it now. And then you're going to, like, you're going to retrospectively go back and just go, oh, this shit is awesome. Stay tuned.
For the zero subscribers on Street Smart Video, I have raised my eyebrows because I am in disbelief that that'll ever happen. Because, you know, it's a decent story, you know what I'm saying? It, you know, putting Pitbull number two over and all that other shit and shit. But we're going to put it over. And this nigga crippled and shit, you know what I'm saying? It's a whole perception is reality thing, at least for niggas like me and shit, you know what I'm saying? He's number two on his team. How's he the fucking number one in the company?
We have an ECW spot for Extreme Warfare Volume 1. Stay tuned. Joey at the Nest with a Requiem for a Pit Bull shill on August 23rd in Reading, Pennsylvania. Moving on. We have a replay of the franchise versus Pit Bull number two TV title match with a commercial break. Moving on. August 24th, full card. Featuring Catfight 96, Missy versus Peaches. Gross. And it's set to a song I could not Shazam. I didn't have no clue who sung the song and shit. So, you know who I hit up?
Oh, Mad Jack Slater.
This nigga is 0 for 7. Because he didn't watch the show.
Oh, man, we're in the same club this week.
Shout out to my nigga, Mad Jack Slater.
What's up, player?
We have another ECW spot for the Dr. Azin, recounted by us, Extreme Retro Review, number 211.
You're welcome.
We have the conclusion of Shane versus Pitbull, number two, in the aftermath, aftermatch stuff. Pitbull, number one, gets back into the ring. He hugs Pitbull, number two, gives him a valiant effort, you know, sending moral support shit. And I noticed that he never took his left hand out of his pocket the entire time.
Whoa, what? I wonder what that was about.
We have Hype Central shilling August 23rd and August 24th. Moving on. We have another spot for the Doctor Is In. Moving on. We have another censored t-shirt from Brian Pillman. Like, how many t-shirts do they make of this motherfucker?
Apparently a lot.
We come back to a Pitbull promo. Pitbull number one is pissed. Because he's in a halo. Number two, wishes it was him. What an idiot. What an idiot. I mean, nigga say, man, I'm fucked what up. I'm in this halo. What an idiot. Shit, hell yeah, nigga. That shit suck like shit, man.
See, that's why he's number two. You know what I'm saying? Because Gary was supposed to be the man. You know what I'm saying? But apparently, I don't know, somehow number two end up getting the shine. I guess that's like when Diesel started shining on HBK and shit. He was the nigga's bodyguard. And next thing you know, he the WWF champion. But his name wasn't HBK number two.
Pitbull number one is glad that Pitbull number two is not in Halo.
That's a real nigga right there.
And all this shit leads to another promorama. Starting at 50 minutes and 58 seconds. This is a long one. We got the franchise and Francine living a life and daring anyone to try and stop it. They bounce in a limo. And I must note, you really have to focus on the limo, because if you pay attention to anything around the limo, it looks like New Jack City. Primetime, Brian Lee calls out Tommy Dreamer. Terry Gordy babbles. We have Taz and Fonzie. The Dudley Boys. The Fake Kiss are outside the ECW arena, and they're trying to get a ride to the next show. So Blue Meanie pulls up his coochie cutters shorts to expose even more of his thigh. A car stops. The guy obviously knows Meanie and offers him a ride. This isn't Meanie's first time. All of the Fake Kiss get in. I feel dirty as fuck as they bounce. Dirty as fuck. We have bonus footage from Tales from the Hood. And then they get their ass beat by the Eliminators.
Oh, damn. Keep the feel going.
Overall, this was a good go-home show. It was an effective use of one match, but it was a little bit of overkill on all that fucking shilling. But I give it a thumbs up. kind of fucking ironic, given that my partner in crime didn't even watch the show.
It sounded all right, I guess. You know what I'm saying? But I don't know if it should have been a go-home show, though. I don't know if it was go-home show good.
Regardless of that, with all the vast knowledge that I imparted on you, 252 Legion of Street Smarks, to include my goofing crime over here, please expeditiously load yourself in to the cross-dimensional, gravitational positron for the Extreme Retro Review. Takes you to the August 24th, 1996 show, Natural Born Killers. Until then, life is a work. Make sure you get paid for it. We out. Peace.
Peace.